Welcome. My name is Andreas Tesch. I'm the Chief Market Officer of Atradius, a leading global credit insurer. I'm pleased to welcome you to the second webinar in a series of virtual events focusing on business topics and trends that are affecting the global trade today. Today's event is focused on how trade relationships and how tariffs are affecting trade worldwide. Before the global pandemic hit, the biggest concern, the biggest risk that was perceived was an increased possible escalation of the trade war between the United States and China. What a change has the pandemic brought to those concerns. Today, we are actually talking about a potential war of vaccines. In our last webinar, we talked about a potential acceleration of globalization due to the pandemic, but maybe those changes in business relationships and trade relationships and the tariffs might have a negative impact on them. We have some fantastic speakers on our panel today who I'm confident will provide food for thought and a very interesting discussion for the coming 60 minutes. Before we get started, I'd like to introduce our moderator for today's event. And I'm very happy and proud to have Daisy McAndrew again as our moderator. Daisy has vast experience as an economic and political journalist for the likes of BBC, Sky News, ITV, and Euronews. We're very fortunate to have you, Daisy. Over to you.
Andreas, thank you so much. And if there's one thing more flattering than being invited once, it's being invited back. So from on behalf of myself, I just want to say how very, very touched and pleased I am to be hosting another one of these events. And if the last one's got anything to go by, then it's sure to be a fantastic event. As you say, we cover such an important topic and such a topical area as well at the moment. You just mentioned vaccines. And it's not just the topic that's going to make this conversation very, very interesting. It's our fantastic panel. So let me briefly introduce them to you. Delighted to have with us Dr. John C. Hulsman. He's president and managing partner of his own political risk consultancy, John C. Hulsman Enterprises. Now, along the way, he has made something of a name for himself as being able to uncannily predict global geopolitical risk. So we're hoping for a bit more of that from him today. And we are also very lucky to have Lesley Batchelor, OBE. Throughout her 35-year career, has picked up a number of very prestigious awards, including the CBI's Businesswoman of the Year and the CEO of the Year from the Congress of Trade Associations. And last but not least, Gordon Cessford. Gordon is Regional Director for Atradius in North America, which covers, of course, the US and Canada and Mexico. Gordon's got a really long track record in banking and financial services, got more than 25 years experience in the credit insurance industry to call on, and is hugely experienced in international trade with an insight into tariffs and other trade challenges. He's worked all over the world, and before taking up his current post in the States, he was responsible for operations throughout the Asia Pacific region. So a very, very warm welcome to our fantastic panel. And with that, John, I'd love to start with you, if I may. Obviously, in the last few months, we've had a change of president in the White House. What difference is that going to make to trade relations?
Well, I mean, I think I'd start with the singer-songwriter Paul Simon. After changes upon changes, we are more or less the same. This would be a huge takeaway, I think, for your audience. Yes, there's vitriol between the two parties. They actually hate each other, as opposed to my day in the 2000s, when we didn't quite hate each other. We disliked each other, perhaps, but there wasn't hatred. We worked together. That's gone now, and that's a pity in a lot of ways. But despite this vitriol, and despite not hanging out in the same places, dating one another, reading the same newspapers, or having anything to do with one another, the two things that will remain the same from the Trump era to the Biden era are fundamental. One is the view of China, and the second is the view of trade. There's almost no difference whatever between the two views, and nor will this change, would be the second takeaway for the audience. This is now where we're heading. Why do I say this? Over China, when I was there, the biggest sea change for me leaving in 2006 to now, running my global firm, is that when I left, everyone in Washington believed in the Ralph Waldo Emerson theory of China. Our great American philosopher Emerson said, every man is a conservative after dinner. And so the thinking was, let's keep China well fed. The better China does, the more it will become pluralist, the more it will work with us, the more it will be a responsible stakeholder. And pretty much everybody believed this, from George W. Bush through the Obama administration's early years. Now, when one goes back, no one believes this. Everyone sees China as a threat to the American established order. The second area of consensus, oddly enough, is trade. One forgets that historically the Republican Party is the party of free trade. NAFTA only passed, the last great American trade initiative passed, with Bill Clinton, 12 new Democrats, and all the Gingrich Republicans. Clinton managed to co-opt the Republicans and get credit for it, which is why he was a very good political leader. But it was the Republican votes that did it. The Democrats tend to be protectionists. What's happened now is the Democratic Party has moved far left of where it was when Clinton was president, or indeed even when Obama was president. And you see this becoming an increasingly protectionist party. And you can see this by them jettisoning the Comprehensive and Progressive Trans-Pacific Partnership, CPTPP, a deal signed by Obama, Biden, and Hillary, all of whom disavowed it because the base wouldn't put up with it. So the Democrats are firmly protectionist. On the other hand, Trump led an unfriendly takeover of the Republican Party. Remember Slow Energy Jeb? That was the free trading base of the party, the establishment that when I was there ran things and went to Council on Foreign Relations meetings with me. That's gone. It's Trump's party now. By every polling measure, he would win the nomination in 2024 to the shock of many, but he would. About half the party is solidly behind him, and the party is solidly protectionist. So as an analyst, if I'm using my crystal ball, if you have one China policy for both parties and one trade policy for both parties, you can know the outcome, and more, you can know that that outcome is going to be enduring for quite some while.
Lesley, when we're looking at the states and the new situation and the new establishment in the White House, does that make life for trading with the states easier, harder, or just the same?
Well, to be quite honest, I mean, business is business, isn't it? So effectively, I think it's going to be more or less the same, except, of course, the way we're really looking at it now is, of course, I think we think that Biden's going to be a more acceptable face of this protectionism, in that he'll actually tell us very nicely that he's not going to do anything, whereas the other chap was a bit brutal. And of course, you know, especially if you're British, you know, we find this a little bit shocking, the behaviour of Trump. In actual fact, a lot of us probably agreed with some of the things he did, because he really was coming out with some quite radical things. And he was challenging things that had been accepted for a very long time. But in actual fact, doing business with the Americans is one of the things that I think people write books on, because it's such a vast country. And, you know, I work with businesses sometimes and they have no idea of the scale of it. And I don't think they have any idea, especially when you're dealing with like intellectual property, and you're in a circumstance where you have to look at federal law and local state law as well, you know, and it starts to become so much more complex. It's a very complex market to work with. It's very rewarding as long as you get to that right position. You know, we do a lot of work with people trading in America, and they're always shocked by the sheer scale of it all.
We might come back to some of those. Gordon, we've got a Brit sitting in the States and we've got an American sitting in Europe. So let's get your perspective. How do you think that the Biden presidency will affect American businesses?
So I kind of liken it a little bit to a cocktail, that there's a few measures of positivity in there with a large dash of caveat. So kind of on the positive side, there is a feeling of calm here now, and I haven't been in the US for so long, but there is a greater feeling of calm, or at least kind of less uncertainty in the corporate community. Under normal circumstances, and we know we're not under normal circumstances, that would lead to, from a business perspective, stability, a longer term view when looking at making investment decisions, strategic growth decisions, etc. Broadly, under Biden, commentators expect the value of the dollar to decrease. So for US exports and exporters, those US produced goods will become more attractive to overseas buyers. So that's a plus for the export community. Globally, we're kind of all expecting a fairly strong economic rebound in 2021. GDP is likely to recover by about 5% following a 3.9% contraction last year. Trade, we're expecting to rebound between 7 and 8% after a similar contraction last year. But, and here's where the large dash of caveat comes in, we've still got the pandemic to contend with. And really, if you talk to corporate America, that's really at the forefront of the concerns right now. So stimulus package, great, will assist hugely. The Build Back Better kind of follow-ups that are now being discussed, brilliant, will add further confidence. But business closures, supply chain disruption, et cetera, continues to be concerning. So for me, the jury's still out. We need to be patient. We need to allow those vaccination programs globally to progress, not just in the US, which has made some big strides forward, but globally. And then await a return to kind of normal, if you like, in terms of trade and opportunities.
John Gordon's just mentioned the biggest story in trade as far as the news is concerned at the moment, which is, of course, the vaccination and trade wars going on around the vaccinations. Where do you think we are now? We know that, well, we understand that discussions between the EU and the UK are ongoing, and then we've got, we've got our own situation, or their own situation in the States. How are you reading this?
Well, I think the EU is trying to desperately row back, which is the right thing to do. I think Mrs. Merkel musing aloud this week about the importance of supply chains was my favorite moment. One tries to have a sense of humor about doing what I do for a living, or one would be angry or find it funny, and I go for funny. And Mrs. Merkel musing aloud that everyone's pointing fingers at us and we don't like it and we're desperately trying to buck past, but then there's supply chains to consider. Was a great comment, because she realizes that some of the Pfizer product is made in the UK, and that if we begin to unravel all this, this would be a very bad idea. And this threw a lifeline to the Swedes, the Irish, the Dutch, who were already saying, oh, let's go slow, because these are all trading nations who know how this works. And I think that was a really honest moment, bless her heart, and a good one.
I'm going to borrow a part of a John Allen Paulos quote, which is, uncertainty is the only certainty there is. So, and Andreas said it very well at the beginning of this in his introduction. In 2019, we were all kind of concerned about, escalation in trade war between US and China. And then suddenly we're talking about supply chain disruption at the beginning of 2020, and then a full-on pandemic. So companies, wherever you are in the world, were either ordered to close or they had to change their operating practices and procedures, which led to those supply chain disruption. It led to cash flow impact. And that's kind of very much in our, in our business. So in terms of how, if you like, companies can manage and mitigate those risks, only way really is to have a robust risk management process. That includes strong credit management. It includes being agile and able to quickly respond to crises and to opportunities. As always with risk management, understand the risk, step one, manage the risk, step two, and then mitigate if necessary, step three. Now, if I look at some of the things that John is saying, that's great information. That's to have that information to hand when making decisions, when exporting or importing or doing business, that's great information to have. So that kind of macroeconomic environment is great information to have. Then, of course, you dig further down into your business. So your own dynamics of your market, your product, et cetera. And then down into the next level, which is very much where Atradius plays, as you know, in terms of the credit risk of the customer, the buyer. Know your customer, KYC, is something that banks have been doing for many, many years, and it's really, really important for corporates to also be doing the same. Also important to say, it's not just at the beginning of a relationship, okay? It's about that ongoing assessment of the supply chain, your customer supply chain, plan and strategize about what happens if something goes wrong. What's that continuity plan? And we've all been tested through this pandemic, and that's an important test. Then from a mitigation perspective, obviously, we have tools available. Credit insurance is one of them. allowing companies really to take those risks in a safe and secure way, and at least remove some of that uncertainty.
Lovely, Gordon. And so, Lesley, I guess there we've got, you know, we now know what we think the problems might be. We've had some very good advice on how to mitigate that. But of course, you know, there are meant to be organisations that are meant to keep us safe when it comes to trade, particularly the World Trade Organization is meant to be our knight in shining armour, isn't it? And we've got a new leader in there. She's only just taken up her position earlier this beginning of this month, Nigeria's former finance minister. How much can the WTO do to protect us all? How good at its job is it? And what do you think she will think as her number one or top three things in her in-trade?
I think WTO are great in terms of their aspirations. I'm really, really looking forward to the new DG being able to take this forward and having the support of all of the countries behind her, because I think she's not a political person in that respect at all. And we're looking forward to them looking at, you know, globalization, because it is a good thing, you know, the general system of preferences where we help smaller, less developed countries actually trade on a more even playing field. I think these are really important issues to try and level up the playing field. You know, we're doing quite a lot of work on helping people understand how the WTO works. I wish that each country would spend some time teaching their own children about trade and exactly what it all means, because actually then we wouldn't have these confusions over how, you know, the trade tariffs are not barriers, they're actually part of the whole process. You know, the documentation exists because we need to understand where goods are going. So it's a really important element to it all. And I think globalization, we've seen it bring so many people out of poverty. We don't really want to get too protectionist about this. I think the risks that people are taking are in some cases, they're oblivious to them. And I really want people to be aware of them so that they actually understand. So if they carry on with the risk, that's fine. But if they can mitigate against it or find a solution for it, I think that's where we're coming from at the moment.
Gordon, I want to pick your brain as somebody who's worked in all major trading regions and perhaps is in a position to compare and contrast America's Europe, Asia. When we're thinking about trading in those different regions, how do attitudes on these issues, trade relations and tariffs, differ? And how can businesses use that information to the best of their ability?
Yeah, I think it's an interesting point, because I'm a firm believer that actually wherever you are in the world, whichever geography you operate in, the kind of the fundamentals, the building blocks of trade are the same, right? Conducting your due diligence, being prudent in your risk management, being open and communicative with customers, with clients, etc. They are the same, whether you're based in the US, whether you're based in Hong Kong, Taiwan, wherever it happens to be. I think what's kind of more prevalent is kind of the moves which are more local, if I can say it that way, which is, you know, if you look in Asia, obviously China is the major economy. China has always been known as a big exporter. They're now trying to move away from that export-orientated investment towards more consumption-led domestic move, including supply and demand, etc., to kind of make them a bit more sort of shock-resistant to what's going on outside of China. As I mentioned earlier, in the US, we've got a slightly different feeling now with Biden, the pandemic fiscal support, great news. And it's a strong message to the economy that, you know, this is we're here to support. The new administration hasn't yet. I know there have been some initial meetings with China, but we haven't really seen how that's going to pan out. And John alluded to it earlier. It could be quite interesting to see how that moves forward. Obviously, tariffs remain. And so, you know, how that relationship develops between the US and China post-Trump will be interesting. Obviously, around the world, we've got the different trade organizations, USMCA, CPTPP, RCEP. We've got post-Brexit. We've got, obviously, the United Kingdom, and Lesley's very, very well aware of this, out there looking for opportunities and deals to be done. So I would say that businesses, honestly, tend to be pretty pragmatic when it comes to, you know, trade, tariffs, et cetera, et cetera. What they all strive for, though, is the opportunity to grow and the opportunity to trade securely.
And Lesley, just on some of those points, I completely take Gordon's point that, you know, trade is trade. But I've also spoken to so many businesses who have tried to export to particularly Asia and the Far East and have really been stung by different, you know, intellectual property issues and cultural issues with trading. And I wonder whether that's been your experience.
Well, it has. And I think the biggest thing that businesses do is they fail to prepare properly for this sort of eventuality. Things like intellectual property, honestly, you know, you have to make a really big decision. You're either going to keep it secret and then you can keep it all to yourself. We always used to say, well, if you really want to keep it secret, put it under your bed and don't let anybody see it. But of course, that's not really going to help you if you want to, you know, you want to sell things.
You want to sell it.
Yes, exactly, make money. So you do have to brace yourself in some ways, you know. But yeah, absolutely. I think people don't research thoroughly enough. And I don't think they find out about what the competition's going to be. And now increasingly we're finding about tariffs. Of course, tariffs can impact on the price that people can you can charge for your product in that market. You know, the local taxes, what we call VAT, there's always a fiscal tax somewhere. That's going to impact on your pricing as well. You know, you've got to have a think about that. And sometimes people have a tax against, you know, protecting certain businesses, you know. So, you know, it's that type of thing. You've got to just research and find out what you're doing.
John, just coming back to you, and obviously one of the things that's also struck me when I've been talking to exporters, and this is a sort of much more parochial UK issue, but that they don't know where to go for advice. And actually there is a lot of advice out there that's really very good. I mean, governments and politicians are very bad at a lot of things, but they do seem to be quite good at giving really practical advice, but people don't seem to know that it's out there.
No, I think that's right. You have to, as Lesley and Gordon were saying, you have to kind of know where to look, but there are real differences. Like Lesley, I mean, I've spent the last third of my working life in Europe, and the number of people who are going to Asia with the kind of seven cities of gold in their mind, you know, that they just show up and they'd find the golden ingots and they'd head back and spend 6 months. And it sounded like us founding Jamestown a little bit. And most of those people starved to death, to keep the analogy going. And they'd come back tail between their legs and said, I didn't know I'd have to give up all my intellectual property to a joint partner who then dumped me after four years. And I said, well, why ever not? Because there's all kinds of evidence out there that that's what happens. This isn't hidden. This isn't some Bond villain going on. The Chinese are very clear about what they're trying to get out of this. They have a huge internal market that's booming. And in return for that, they want certain things. That's how policies are made. And that I mean, you know, we were talking a little earlier about the difference. I mean, you know, CPTPP and RCEP, to me, yeah, there's all kinds of trade aspects, but basically these are geoeconomic moves on the board, and that's how they should be looked at. Mm-hmm. RCEP isn't going to change much of anything. It formalizes things that are already there, and that's great, and it's very big and very shallow. You know, it gets rid of tariffs that are already really low over a 20-year period. Well, it beats a poke in the eye with a sharp stick, but it's not the revolutionary thing that it is. What it is a brilliant geostrategic move. After the Americans leave CPTPP, you're left with the Chinese saying, I can set the rules. More and more, we're being open, they're being shut, and the gravity comes to us, and we don't care if this works particularly well or not. We want Japan, South Korea, Australia, New Zealand to remember as that they're siding with the Americans on security matters, that on economic matters, we're where it's at for you, and hesitate about putting all your eggs in the American basket. And they've succeeded brilliantly in doing that, while the Americans have all been uniting around this anti-trade policy. The chink in the Biden armor, the chink in the American position to be anti-Chinese and protectionist, is you can be one but not the other very well. If you're anti-Chinese, but you don't do what Obama tried to do with TPP and write the rules and write a really deep, vigorous trade deal that you set the norms and then the Chinese have to come to you, if that's not what's going to happen, you're losing out here. So this is geoeconomics, part of geopolitics. Not to say it doesn't matter, but I mean, as Lesley and I were talking the other day, these things aren't separated, and the way to see them is together. And so that then makes sense of that mystery. It's not nothing, but it's not nothing. It's something economically, but it's a great deal more geoeconomically.
John's saying really it's something for the politicians to be concerned about, but not something for most of us to worry about. Would you agree?
Well, I do agree. I think obviously, you know, it's like everything. If it impacts on your life, you're going to worry about it. And I think the tariffs are beginning to impact on people's lives. And I think when the EU and the US had their spat, and you know, the Harley Davidsons were, you know, and the Cranberries were, you know, blocked, and then we had Scottish whiskey, I mean, of all things, blocked. You know, these things are really big deals, and then they begin to impact on everybody. And then that's why I think it's so important that people should learn about how trade works.
Yeah,
absolutely. If you're trading with a country, you don't often go to war with them.
No, you want to feather your nest, not actually go to war. I'm going to have a quick look at the questions on the Slido system. Nadia sent a question in saying, it's the next one. This is the obvious one for Lesley. How are relationships between the UK and the rest of the world related to tariffs now that it's outside of the European Union? We almost got away without really talking about Brexit, but I think we probably can't avoid it completely.
Of course, we don't call it Brexit any longer. We now call it the EU transition. And you know, relationships, I've been advising businesses over the last 4 years, talk to your customers, stay in touch with your customers, make sure that you know they know that you want to do business with them still, and really try and find a way around it. And I think most businesses are. I do appreciate that there's been so many new rules that have come in. It's been quite difficult to do business, and it has taken a bit of a knock. But I think people are getting back on the horse again.
Gordon, what capacity is left within major world governments to continue trade and economic support should the pandemic linger even into next year, 2022? So what capacity is left? And Gordon, also, so any other top tips that we haven't given people on exporting? If you're an SME, this particular question is saying they have a very small team. So handy tips for exporting and the bigger issue of what do we do if the pandemic continues to linger?
Well, let's hope, first of all, that it doesn't, that these vaccination programs really do get pushed through. And I think we'll very quickly get through this. But governments have been very quick to support fiscally, as we saw in the US. They've also, in parts of Europe, amended bankruptcy laws, etc. So I think we may see, and Atradius is predicting an uptick in insolvency, corporate insolvencies, by around 26% in 2021. That's a big uptick, because actually what the surprise was in 2020 was that businesses survived, because you know there was a patience, there was an amendment in some of the legislation, there was stimulus package, etc. That's not going to be able to be fully run through into 2021. So we will see a change there. A quick comment on Asia before I get to your final question, which is just everyone I think knows, but it's worth remembering, it's not a homogenous market. Okay, it's a complex jigsaw of countries with different cultures, different languages, different legal systems, regulatory environments, etc. And to Lesley and John's point of view, you've got to do your homework. You've got to have advice, whether that's export councils, consulates, embassies, trade missions, et cetera, and have good local partners. In terms of SMEs, what can they do? Again, tap into those people who are able to support you, who are able to give you the advice, who are able to perhaps guide you in the right direction, so that you don't waste time and those scarce resources which you've got on trying to talk to too many people. Really hone in on the right opportunity.
And Lesley, I'm going to we've had a couple of questions for you. One talking about a post Angela Merkel world and what that will mean for trade and in with her departure. Another question that's come in saying, do you think there'll be a direct agreement for a free flow between UK and US for what it concerns vaccines and components?
This is a big big step for Germany, you know, to go from someone who has dominated in that space for 20 years now, you know, huge respect for Angela Merkel, you know, absolutely incredible. You know, it's going to be difficult and there's going to be disruption. But I think this whole, you know, the pandemic, you know, everything is all about disruption at the moment, you know, and we've just got to try and hopefully, run through it all, you know.
And I know you've got opinions on Merkel. You've got about 30 seconds to give us your opinions on Merkel. And also, I can't resist, there's one last question saying, can John tell us if Trump will run again? So very briefly, give us your insight on that.
Just when we thought we were safe. To Merkel, I mean, I agree with Lesley. The shoes are huge. The thing to watch for political risk is, can these guys fill them? I mean, they're off to a terrible start in the regional elections. Lachey's already in trouble. He's as boring as Merkel without the steadiness and the tactical acumen. So I think there's a real problem there. Soder would be the replacement, and the CSU Bavarians have always had a hard time up in Berlin doing well, be it Stoiber or Franz Josef Strauss. So I think watch how the CDU does it crumble. She's that big a figure. I think that's a moment of risk too to watch. We didn't have time, but I could throw in Draghi, but the Merkel point is excellent. Last point about Trump. A lot of things depend. If he isn't indicted and if his health is good, I think he'll try again.
Thank you, Daisy. And I think it's been extremely interesting and inspiring. And as a German, it's particularly interesting to listen to a British and an American expert talking about German politics. I won't share my view, but I would like to thank all the panelists. And I want to thank you, Daisy, again, for providing an excellent moderation and not running too long over time, even though it's been enormously interesting. It's been clear that global trade tensions continue to exist. Countries will continue to try and protect their own interests. And apparently it doesn't really matter who's running the White House. The protectionism is gonna continue listening to John's view. Frictions between trading nations have always existed. They will continue to exist. One of the questions was whether free trade is ever going to be a reality. And I think today's discussion has shown that we cannot expect that to happen in the foreseeable future. But the good news is that as long as companies are preparing for it, they can cope with it, they can benefit from it, they can benefit from this increasing globalization, but they need to be prepared. So thanks for sharing all your insights and sharing your recommendations as well. And we will have a next webinar on the 5th of May. We will talk about the impact of digitalization on the credit world. So please join us for the next upcoming event. It was my pleasure to bring this event today to you. And thank you for joining. And I look forward to seeing you at the next event. Thank you again.